Vata Puru will gather for the first day in my school. Good morning, teacher. Akurana Vayamame, Mauludu or Kanduri. He is known as the Khalifa. Circumcision ceremony is something like a mini wedding without the bride. So I give a small shapadu, which is known as a sadangu. Recite various verses about there was a very successful volleyball team in Akura. Various beliefs our people had. They are not Kochika Sutra. It is known as Mandirika.
Yes, you have seen that too.
I have seen that also. Magic powder or something like that is mixed there. So say Tinna Kurutu. Tinna Kurutu means given to eat or walk over that. That's the end of you.
Welcome to the program. Thank you for joining us. This time we are going to speak to engineer Samoon Jalaluddin. He comes from Akurana. He grew up in the olden days in Sri Lanka and many parts of the country. And of course, he has vivid memories of growing up, particularly in Kandy region. So let's go and meet him. Assalamualaikum, brother Samoon.
Alaikum assalam to all. I'm very happy that you have invited me to share my memories, particularly during the 50s and 60s, when I was just starting school and then moving on to my teens and my university days. Thank you very much once again.
Yeah, it's a pleasure to have you. Let's talk. Okay, let's start with your name. You are engineer Samoon Jalaluddin.
Actually, my initials are JM, standing for Jalaluddin Muhammad Samoon.
Yeah. Okay, you have a Vasagama?
My Vasagama is Vatapuruve Gadara Jalaluddin Muhammad Samoon.
Okay. That's good to hear. We all have Vasagama in Kandy region.
Particularly, I think most of us have this Vasagama.
Okay, now tell me about your father.
My father is H.M. Jalaluddin, H.M. standing for Habib Muhammad. Father was one of those earliest people from Akurana who was interested to get his children to study English. So he was one of the very few who sent us away from Akurana to Katukastota. Actually, I studied at St. Anthony's College from my kindergarten until I entered university. So only a very few students at that time went out of Akurana for their education. So my father was one of the few parents who actually wanted us to go out of Akurana and get our education.
Right. Tell me more about your father. What did he do?
Father was, father studied at Sri Rahula College in Katukastota. Well, that's also a very old school, even it is existing today, Sri Rahula College. And once he completed his, he studied only up to his JSC, that means 8th standard. But he knew his English very well, and he was one of the people who the Akurana people came for various translations or to fill up forms which they had to do in English. So father, after his education, he did business. Although he did business, like most of the Akurana people, he did not want to go out of Akurana for the reason that he wanted to be with us, so that we will be more into studying and not playing about. Because most of Akurana people as you also would have known, were businessmen who had their business in Akurana, but most of them went to where now Dambulla, Kakirava, Polonnaruwa, Anuradhapura, Kaduruvela. So most of them were like that. And even my family, immediate family members, were doing their business in Akurana. Although they requested my father to open a business in Kakirava, he didn't want to leave us because for the simple reason that he had to be there for, so that we will be very sort of regular in our school attendance. Also, we will be doing our studies every day. And so he stuck to Akurana doing his business, which was he did tea business, actually selling loose tea. Because father was more or less, his background was dealing in tea. Because he was once an employee of a tea factory belonging to one of his uncles in Alavathukoda, known as Saiston Estate. So he was hired there for a salary of 35 rupees per month, and father was the one who used to write the accounts and maintain all their books. So that way, father was doing business. Later, with some of his friends from Matale, some Hindu friends particularly, they were Mr. Ganesh and Mr. Chellaya. They all got together and bought a small piece of tea estate at North Matale. And father was also running that tea estate. Although he was running the tea estate at North Matale, he made it a point to be at home. Once he leaves early morning, he is usually there by 6 o'clock in the evening. So that way, he was always behind us, pushing us to, you know, do our work, studies, and behave well. And you know, he was always behind our backs, so that we don't sort of go sort of, you know, out of the path which he had wanted us to go. So he ran this shop in Akurana, the tea shop, till the early 70s. So he was, our shop was situated in front of the present post office. So he had a shop there. My uncle had the adjacent shop. So he was there, so he didn't want to go out and earn more money, because his preference was that we sort of study well and come out sort of, you know, successful. Father was, you know, involved in our studies and also social service, where he was with his friends doing various services to the community and taking part in all the mosque affairs during the, you know, and also for the welfare of the village. And he was also helping. There were quite a lot of uneducated people those days. Even very simple things like filling up a form was a little beyond the society which existed in the early 50s and maybe late 40s, which I don't remember. I remember actually from the year which I can recollect from the 1952. So from that onwards, father was there till we passed out and even beyond. So he never left Akurana, so to say.
So yeah. What are some of the things you can remember as a child? How early you can remember? You were born in 1945, around that time.
Yeah, in 44 April.
Yeah.
So I could remember, the earliest which I can recollect is 1951. And it all started, my school and my education. Later on to anything else which you would like to know. So once I was in a bus with my father. Probably he was taking me to the doctors, or maybe I was sick or having fever. Then when we passed the St. Paul's College, which is in front of the Maligawa, where the earlier the courts were situated, there was the St. Paul's College. So while we were passing St. Paul's College, there were a lot of students sitting around a tree and a teacher with a cane, you know, walking around. So I asked my father, Papa, what is that? And I pointed out that at the class which was outside, an outside class. Then he said, that is a school and they are holding a class, and very soon I also will, you know, I will, you know, put you to school. Then, you know, immediately I felt a lot of disappointment for having asked my father this question about why I did this and asked him to explain what was happening. Because I thought that question only made him put me to school. So if I had not asked him the question, at that time I was thinking, if I had not asked that question, he would not have put me to school and I would have been a free bird without attending school. So that was one incident which I remember, which was the earliest I could say. Then in 1951, he had applied to put me to Trinity College, and that Trinity College had refused to accept me because at that time they didn't have vacancies. And that letter written in 1950, I have found that in one of my father's files. So later he had put me to St. Anthony's, and the first day in school, before he sent me to school, he said, as you see the teacher, tell good morning. So I went there. You know, I was stuck for words because it was the first day in my school and the children were being taken into the class one by one and showing their hands so that the teacher was checking them whether they have cut their nails and whether their hands are clean. So I was looking at my hands, the fingers, and was very sort of, you know, excited whether I'd be caught with my hands dirty or with my fingernails not cut. So I went and waited close to the teacher. Then as she looked at me, I can remember, I said in a loud voice, good morning, teacher. So that is one vivid memory which I have of the first day in my school. Even during my university days, I at Akurana, we formed the Akurana YMMA with Mr. V.S.M. Subhai, Dr. Larif Subhai's father, as the president. That was more or less in the maybe early 70s. But there had been a YMMA even earlier, during the early, late 50s and early 60s. But that was defunct for some time, and we formed it again in the early 70s, where Mr. Subhai was the president, and there was a sort of quite a large crowd of educated people and all of, you know, from Akurana. So where we formed YMMA, and I was there were two vice presidents and I was one of those, and we did a lot of service. In fact, we published a magazine called Alum Play. So which is which was, you know, we collected articles from various sources. That is, sources in this sense, where even I wrote an article about cutting costs when building a house, how to cut costs and how to build a low-cost house, but a comfortable house. It was my article. And there was an article by late Mr. S.M. Jeffrey. He wrote about the geography of Akurana. And there were various other articles on, you know, the subjects of social importance. And it was quite a successful magazine, which we sold at 5 rupees at the time. And we sold quite a lot of those magazines in Akurana, Kandy, Kratikostoto, Galina, Mahatare, and so on. So it was one of the big projects sort of we as Akurana IMMA members, we did that. And later, we encourage various sports, particularly cricket and soccer. So, but soccer didn't catch on, but even as always, there was a very big demand to be in the Akurana cricket team. So like that, well, we were doing a lot of service and, even for personal fitness and entertainment. Leisure time, earlier there was a very successful volleyball team in Sri Lanka. First I'll touch on the sports aspect. There was a very successful volleyball team in Akurana, where we were Central Province Kandy District champs. Maybe once or even twice, I can remember, as far as I remember. And there were quite a few, only one member of that team is still living. Apart from that, most of the, star players have now left us and there are no more. But it was a very successful team. They brought lot of honor to Akurana, because even the Sri Lankan volleyball team visited Akurana and we played 3 matches with them. And I can very well remember one game where we scored 8 points versus the Sri Lankan national team. So in fact, the captain of that team was one Mr. Srivardhana. He was one of the star players, I should say, even in Asia. So our team played against them and we were able to score in one match 8 points, one match 6 points, like that. So anyway, we lost all three, but even then that was a proud moment for all of Akurana. It was captained by one Mr. I.A. Gafur, who died in 1916. He's one of my uncles on my mother's side. Mother's Malwana Hinna. He married from Malwana Hinna. His brother-in-law, I wonder whether most of them knew, he was one Mr. Hanifa, and one Mr. Ismail, S.H. Ismail, who was a inspector of schools, I think, education, post. He was one Mr. Ismail. So Ismail's brother-in-law was Mr. Hanifa, and Gafur married Mr. Hanifa's sister. And there were one Mr. Naufa, Mr. Gafur, another Gafur. There was one Mr. Tahir, and there were two good players. They were stars of Kandy. There were one Mr. Dawood and Mr. Habib Muhammad. So this Dawood and Habib Muhammad, they went on to play for the Kandy district team also. And Dawood was one of the very feared, smashers, the dash. So Yeah, and we attended a tournament in Bandar, where we hired a bus, and about 25 of us we went to for that 3-day tournament in Bandar, and we were knocked out in the quarterfinal stage. And the army team went on to win the cup. In Akurana, my small days, maybe in the 50s or in the early 60s, there were various social events which have now, you know, no more, actually disappeared. Those events, one is the what we know as Mauludu or Kanduri, which is normally held during the month of Rabiul Awwal. I think it is the month where our Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was born. So during that month, from the very first day up to the end of the month, everywhere, most of the places, they hold what is known as a Kanduri, where, a lot of alims are invited, and even the community people, we take part, and we recite what is known as Bait. The most of it is praising the Prophet. You know, all those, there are about 10 or 12 bites. So that is sort of, you know, every house from the very first day, they invite the village known people, their relations. So they have this Mauludu, and then they have a dinner and they disperse. Likewise, there is something known as Ratib, where with open-ended drums, there is a Ratib, there are particular teams of people comprising 8 people, 10 people, depending on the number of people you are asked to bring. This Ratib, there is a person who is in charge of that Ratib team. He is known as the Khalifa. So the Khalifa is told to bring a Ratib team. We'll say, it says, today in my house I invite them. And I invite the village, the neighbors, the relations, and this Ratib is held. Ratib means even they also recite various verses while beating the drums. So that goes on for about, you know, usually they start at about 9:30, 10 o'clock. They begin with about 7:30, they get together. They have a small meal with kiribat and maybe jaggery milk. And, that is a sort of something like starters. And then this Ratib starts and goes on till about 12, 1 o'clock in the late night. So this is a day of fun for small boys like us, because it was an opportunity for all our friends to get together at one time, that also at night time. It is very rare that we get together at night. So night time, and we play various games, chasing each other, playing, robbers and policemen and various other games. So till 1 o'clock at night, this Ratib goes on. Then the dinner is held, and then they disperse after that. So that is more or less quite a lot of households, they hold that during those months. Then there is the functions, social functions, like the circumcision ceremony. Circumcision ceremony is something like a mini wedding without the bride. Because, without the bride, the boy is usually about 10 to 12 years old. They wait a long time for the circumcision. So, in fact, I was 9 years when I was circumcised. So, in fact, we are just as marvelous with the best of Samsung, not the marvelous. We were dressed as marvelous, and I think my father chose the Pakistani Muhammad Ali Jinnah suit. I can remember that. You know, that's really for that. And the best part is we are taken in a procession to the town, that is the 6 mile post bazaar. So as I told you earlier, our functions, because of the lack of space in our mother's house, we used to have it at my father's house. So from my father's house, we were brought in a procession to Akurana. Then we were taken through the town like a Pudumapuri. And then we are brought back again. Then the dinner is held. And late at night only we realize what is, you know, what we are, you know, this is why they did all this. So that was, you know, real enjoyable event, because all my friends are all in various levels of, you know, they have their circumcision ceremonies. Then the next thing, the weddings. Wedding also, the Mahapuri, even if their house is your next door, the bride's house, he is taken in a procession to 6 mile post. And he is dressed in, you know, sarong, mostly sarong and trouser. And then he is, and people garland him. And he is taken in a procession with a lot of crackers being lit, you know, lot of crackers. Then we take him to Akurana, where each and every shop, they sort of, you know, give a small, put a table, put a white cloth over that, and then a chair, and he's given a small drink of orange barley or some, you know, cream soda or something like that. So every shop gives it. So by the time he comes home, he has about 5-6 tons of orange barley he has taken. So that is given, and he's taken right up. Because for courtesy's sake, he just takes a sip. And then he leaves the glass, you know, almost full. Then somebody there will take that glass and have a drink on that, on his account. So it is some sort of, it was real fun. And in the street, you know, there are certain people who knew the, known as Chinadi and Salambadi, which is a sort of a Chinese art, where to Chinadi is some sort of a karate or display, display of the martial arts. So there were 2-3 famous people in the Akurana Bazaar. So always every wedding day, and all people, you know, gather around in the middle of the road, these people show their prowess. So that is a martial arts display. Then they are given presents like a handkerchief. So people, after the return, people give handkerchiefs to the participants, usually 2 participants. So that sort of fun, and he's taken. Then while he's been taken, the bride's party. So one I forgot to tell you, you know, we hire the drummers from Mathare, which in the temples in Mathare have the drummers. So those drummers are hired for the occasion. So they are brought together, and with the beating of the drums only, this Mahapuri goes in procession. So when he's halfway, the bride's party comes to welcome him. That also, they have another set of drummers. So they come, and these 2 drummers, they sort of, you know, compete against each other. So it's a sort of a, you know, drumming for the rest of the night.
Right.
So one is trying to show that they are better than the other party.
Right.
So it's a very, very enjoyable occasion with crackers and various types of fireworks, you know. And the Mahapuri is ultimately taken to the bride's place. And then the dinner. And then there this was. So it was the Kalyanam and this Kanduri, the Surnata ceremony, were all sort of, you know, very memorable events in our life. Mm-hmm. So in our day, the crackers stopped. It was stopped. The drummers were stopped. Mm-hmm. And in my wedding, I had to come in the procession because the road was not motorable that time. It was. So from halfway earlier, I had to get into a car and right. then come as the bridegroom to my house mm-hmm. here. So nowadays, it's all changed, and even the small boys, it will be sort of news to them.
Yes, yes.
So these were the social events, and yes. there was another event, Doctor, which I would like to mention, which was in a way helping out people. You know, now suppose my sons are being circumcised, so I give a small shapadu, which is known as a sadangu. Mm-hmm. Sadangu means you invite the people, but they are expected to come and, you know, after lunch, we maintain an exercise book and they come and donate something. 10 rupees, 5 rupees, 15 rupees, like that. Everybody who comes there in the village, they will donate. So, and their names are written down and the sum contributed. So that is there, but it's a sort of a, you know, unwritten agreement that will be returned when the
other person holds something. Okay.
Holds something. It's an unwritten agreement. You have to return that amount or above. Mm-hmm. That is your wish. So that is why it is recorded. And that is kept. So what happens is, now at the end of the day, after his expenses, he has about another 10,000 rupees in his hand. Mm-hmm. So that keeps him going. But, and then he starts contributing whenever some similar occasion is held. Okay, if I have contributed 5 rupees for my neighbor's son's circumcision ceremony, mm-hmm. he will come and contribute the 5 rupees to me in my charge. Mm-hmm. So it was an event which was very popular, and it was held, you know, very, very, you know, all over. I can right. remember. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. this book is kept carefully, and whenever somebody is, now you get an invitation for a sadangu, which is usually by an invitation card. Yeah. So then you take your book and refer. Okay, Mr. Syed Muhammad Lebbe, he has contributed 5 rupees. Then, okay, he goes back. Now this person goes to Mr. Syed Muhammad's place. And then she just has 5 rupees, and that is recorded, and they know that they have now, you know, cancelled each other.
Oh, okay.
So it was a sort of, you know, after your huge expenses, mm-hmm. in fact, spending 5,000, 10,000 mm. was a very huge expense those days. So, in fact, you can buy a car with that money.
Yeah.
So
it is, in that sense, it is some sort of a crowdfunding. In the modern crowdfunding, it used to be like that.
So it was actually, although you have these very essential benefits, you are not sort of, you know, stranded after that. You although even if you have spent all your money, you have another fresh 5,000 or 10,000 for you to carry on with, you know, with your work or whatever it is. So that was a good thing, but that also, you know, gradually
disappeared.
Then there was the, apart from the kanduri, there was the niyat.
Yes.
Which is, I don't know exactly, that is just after this kanduri month. Akulan is divided into 11 divisions. Mm-hmm. So each one is given number 1, 2, 3, 4. So we fell in the number 2 section. Thalmugavta was number 1. Mm. Valikatiya was number 3. Like that, there were various Akulam was divided into 11 sections.
Yeah.
So 11 days continuously, that whole section, the number two section, is today. So yeah. What we do is we invite our relations from the other sections. Yeah. So they all attend, and the main dish is the chicken curry. Mm. Chicken curry is not the same chicken that we are eating now. That was a curry which you get to eat once a year or twice a year. It was not a common dish. So chicken is a special dish. So that is every party. So what happens is, now if it is today's our section, so people from relation from number 3, 4, 5, maybe up to 11, if I have relation, all of them come to our house or our neighbor's house, like that. So and have their meal. And in the evening, there are those boxes made out of, you know, this mat, coconut.
Yeah, the dried grass, yeah.
And that is dried grass.
Is
taken to the
rice box.
Sotapotti is taken to the Grand Mosque.
Yes.
Yeah, to the Grand Mosque.
Yes.
So the whole section will bring. So that's a huge amount of rice. So at the Grand Mosque, from about 2:33 in the evening, there's a huge recital. I'm not quite sure what they recited, but all of us are in the mosque with a handkerchief spread just in front of us, awaiting the, you know, distribution of the rice.
Mm-hmm.
So at the end of all those recitals, the rice is distributed among the gathering who is seated in the mosque, and then the handkerchief.
Okay.
So they come and distribute it, and we bring the rice back home. So it is repeated the next day and the next day until all 11 parties, the sections are completed. Then on the 12th day, all 11 sections, they all do it together. So you can just imagine the amount of rice that day. Because all 12 sections send their contribution, rice contribution, to the Grand Mosque. So that is also that the final day, which is known as the Kodiyat Dal. So there are flags which are hung in the mosque where they face the flag. So these are traditions which slowly, you know, found their, you know, it all.
So what was that kodi about? What is the flag? Is it
flag is, you know, the crescent of the moon, the star, something about Bismillah, Allahu, sort of all those things station that is put there. You can find all around the mosque the kodi. Nowadays you see in other religious places, even the Buddhist temples and all, they hang those kodi. So likewise, I think maybe these are Indian traditions, which with time to come with the modern, with the gaining of more and more knowledge, that these were just traditions and nothing sort of forced by our religion. So that's why they got extinct.
Yeah,
this is some of those social functions which I could remember.
Yeah, but there was another kind of niyat. We used to see all these foods, banana and this paniyaram, and then it's Fatimanachyar.
Fatimanachyar Kanduri or something.
Niyati, yeah.
Which is held by the ladies.
Right.
By the ladies, with a lady religious head. My father-in-law's sister was the main head for this area. So where they also recite various verses about Fatimanachyar. And then Paniyaram and Pachoru.
Right.
That is Kiribat pieces are distributed after that. So, and also that is a time where now maybe about 5-6 houses get together, and then in the main house they give this niyat. So every house That is a sort of a very sort of time of celebration, because we buy this bunch of plants, varakola. So in our house we used to buy about 5 or 6. Sometimes raw plants are brought and we bury it in the ground and apply smoke to that. By burying a pot and making a hole, then we put something and we apply smoke. And after about a week, when you take it, it's all yellow. So, and ripe, fit to be eaten. So, after that, there are plenty of planters for you. We're just hanging inside our grandmother's room. So, whenever we want, we just go there, grab a plant, and then run off to continue with our cricket or something. Then immediately you feel like having another plant and you come back and then just grab another plant and go. So it was all days of fun, which you know, sometimes you sort of feel sad that you miss all those now. That is another event which I can remember.
But there was another one called Odukattu Podan.
Odukattu Podan, but we also used to sort of, you know, not in a very big way, but there were people who wrote these isms in the plate, in a fresh, clean plate, in some sort of ink. I don't know what ink it is. They write Arabic verses, and that is all after they write, so that is washed with water. So it turns a pale blue color, and that you take it. And that is supposed to, you know, cure your drinking. And also coming to this sort of a medical treatment in that way, there was something known as Kochika Sutra. Have you heard Kochika Sutra? Because there were some old women where we put a few pieces of chili, few pieces of salt, a piece of manjal, the turmeric, then a small thread from your shirt, even your shirt, they search for a loose thread. That thread is torn and that also is put there. And a few of your hair, they put that. Then they put all this mix and this lady ask you to sit down, and these are all put in a tattoo, you know, they're made out of pannam, that is, panna ola tattoo. So these are all put, and she recites something and just, you know, rotates it above your head.
Alati.
So, like Alati, this is, this is supposed to cure various diseases like Kanuru and various Sunyam and something like that. But Sunyam was a serious matter, but Kanuru, this was the treatment. So we are forcibly sent to a lady to do that. But when she recites, she takes a different tone altogether from her normal voice, which makes us laugh. So the whole session, we are rolling in laughter, myself and my brothers. So you see, that was one thing. And also, there was a neighbor, old man, which he comes and he, it is known as Mandirichira. Suppose you have a wound in your leg. So he comes to some, there was a plant, something like a weed. It has a sort of a leaf which, as you pluck it, after about 10 minutes it will fade, you know, and almost die, I think. So he will come with that, and over the wound he will recite something and keep on beating the leaf. Then by the time he finishes, that has faded. So that is supposed to have taken away all the bad things from the wound. That is why it has faded. So that was one belief we had. Then there was another thing, there are small babies. They don't sleep at night. Particularly, we had a large family, and my small brothers, well, they were 2 months, 3 months old. So my father used to send my uncle to a, there was a Sigonese man who was a dobi by profession. He is supposed to take a piece of thread and recite something on that in his language, which is not either Sigonese, nor English, nor Tamil. So he recites with holding it over some incense tambalani.
Yes.
Then that is brought, that thread my uncle will bring, and mother used to tie it to the cot. So this guy is now sleeping. So you won't believe, the day that he's tied, he sleeps peacefully. He doesn't disturb at night. So that was something surprising. Yeah. Because I have seen it. From that time, he won't disturb. If not, if the under that he tied to his cord, he won't allow anybody to sleep. So right. That was something which, you know, some sort of old women's magic or belief. Mm. So just to satisfy my mother, my father used to do that and send my uncle to Kudigal and give them 50 cents or something to Mandiriche Nool Mandiriche.
Yes.
Nool Mandiriche, they come and tie it in the cord. Then this guy peacefully sleeps without any disturbance.
So you have seen that too?
I have seen that also.
I mean, you have seen it working, kind of,
or I seem to be working. Mm. And at that time, I was also surprised. See, last night he didn't allow to sleep. Mother was always up. Now he's peacefully sleeping. So that was another thing which I would like to, tell you all during this interview.
Yeah.
So that is that. Then they used to do this Shunyam. They believe in Shunyam.
Yeah.
Shunyam is some people sort of, they say they decide something and make somehow on the sly he's made to eat that. Okay, he's given something, but some sort of magic powder or something like that is mixed there. So if that is eaten, so that man falls sick. This is done by your enemy. So to say, enemy. So what they do is, they want to cut this off. So for that, they have a kataryas. They bring these kataryas from Anuradhapura. They are kataryas like consultant doctors. So they charge also. So these kataryas are brought from, I know one of my uncle's father's brother-in-law. He was always having stomach pain. So Kataria said, because he has been, so say, Tinna Kurutu. Tinna Kurutu means given to eat. That means some of his related relations who are jealous of him have given something to for, and he has eaten that because of that only. So you know what happened? So Kataria said, I can cure this, but he has to be made to vomit. So okay. Kataria gave him a mixture of certain herbs, and you don't believe, this man started vomiting the whole night until morning 64 times, and he was taken to hospital the next day.
Right.
Kataria, he took his money and he went off by 5 o'clock in the morning. Oh. Next day, this man could not even get up. So right. We took him to hospital and admitted him. So these were beliefs of that time, which was generally, it was a common belief, and a lot of people did that. And also, Desika Tarikira. Desika Tarikira means cutting, lime cutting, which is also done as a, it drives away the devil in you. Yeah. The devil is supposed to have come and, enveloped you. It's living inside you. So to chase him away, you cut this Desika Tarikira. So the Kataria comes and we have to buy about 25 lime fruits. Then various other flowers, various things, kinds of flowers. Then some paniyaram. Then various other, you know, katpadakam, incense, various things. They, he arranges it in a particular manner on a cardboard sheet. And then he starts sort of, you know, chanting. Chanting various verses in what language only he knows. So this is chanted the full night it goes. And then at about 3 in the morning, this arrangement, all the flowers and with all this, is taken to a, where the paths meet in a junction. Where one path goes and meets and then two paths branch off.
Okay.
At that junction it is kept at the dead of night. And
right.
And the story is, if you happen to cross that or walk over that, that's the end of you. you will die off. So we are very careful to go from it as far as possible. But you can't go very far also. Because when you are going past that, you are supposed to spit 3 times on that.
Uh-huh.
You have to spit on that. So you can't be far away, you know. So you have to be able to meet so that you can spit
and
three
go.
Times on that. So that was one, you know, during our young days we used to see those things, various
right.
things, and
right.
even my brother forgets, he is forcibly sent, go and spit and come. So he will return and
right.
then spit 3 times and then come back running. So these are various beliefs our
yeah.
people had.
Yeah, yeah.
Which all now is gone.
Yeah.
So these are some things which I remember during my time.
Yes, yes.
So
interesting, yes, yes.
Very, very interesting.
Yeah.
If
yes, when I was a child, these things were there, but they pretty much disappeared when I was a child, I think.
That was the time these things were sort of going out. And people are more educated,
yeah.
you know, gradually people became educated
yeah.
and they knew that these are all, you know, old women's stories, and they gave it up.
Now let's talk about your grandfather again.
Father's father is Uduman Kandu Habib Muhammad.
Yeah.
This is his full name.
So he is the one who had a tea garden, tea plantation.
Yes. Yeah. You know, just a little beyond my father's house, where he was there, he had a plot of land. Actually, it had a peak and it sort of all around it was sort of inclining down. So it was like actually like a cap, you see, at a peak. And from all sides, it was just going round, something like a hemisphere, you see, a hemisphere kept on the, you know, on the semi base. So on that, he had mainly tea plants, tea bushes, along with coconut, mango, cocoa, then spices like karambu, like that.
Mm-hmm.
And every evening he used to go and tend to the tea plantation, where he used to cut the drains and clip these branches, clean the weeds. And you know, he always attended, he was physically very fit until he expired. And we used to accompany him there because there were plenty of, you know, guava, mango during the season. So we used to always accompany him and have a, you know, nice time there picking up guavas and pera and various things and spend our time there.
Uduman Kandu.
Yeah.
So that sounds like a Tamil name. Then again, it looks like there were such names in the past given to a lot of people.
Yes. Because Uduman Kandu was his father's name. Kandu was a sort of name which also, you know, we used to call, I had an uncle called Ismail. He was known as Ismail Kandu. My grandmother used to call him Ismail Kandu, Ismail Kandu. So Kandu was some sort of I don't know whether it's a pet name or some addition, which would have come from Indian tradition. Ambilebbe was a common name those days. Amira Sahibu, Adumilebbe, they were my grandmother's, that is father's mother's brothers. Mm. One was Mira Sahibu, other one was Adumilebbe. My grandmother herself was known as Kadar Umma. And those days, there was a person who used to visit us, particularly to my father's place. He was living in Akurana, but he was then known as Madras Mama. Madras Mama, presently Chennai. So I never got to ask them why he was called Madras Mama. I can remember those days they used to, Nerchai Kadan. Sometimes even I, because I felt very ill at some stage of my baby days, and they had wanted that one day they will take me to Nagur in India and Tiruchirappalli, you know, to satisfy Nerchai Kadan. But the father didn't believe so much in those things, and he never took me to Nagur or Tiruchirappalli. Although I was under the impression that since they have taken this vow, they might take me to India, but it never, you know, it was never happened. Not fulfilled. Yeah. I don't know why it never happened.
Okay, let's briefly talk about your career journey. How did you become an engineer?
The decision to make to be an engineer was made in 1957, just after my those days it was Form 3, 8 level. They gave us a list of, you know, asking our preferences. Then, you know, three of us who were very close friends, all three of us put as engineer. And from that onwards, our stream, our subjects were more, we were in a class which was more towards the engineering. Two of us were selected from the school for engineering. So I happened to be one, and there was another Sinhalese boy, Rex Pereira, university. And my first year was in Colombo. Just after the first year, they shifted the faculty. Earlier, the Faculty of Engineering was in Colombo. Later, they have built the faculty in Peradeniya, and then shifted. So we were the second batch to come to Peradeniya.
So when did you become an engineer? When did you graduate?
I graduated in 1968. Those days, unlike the present, there were not many private firms or big firms, so to say. So we were all aiming at government jobs, and we wait for the gazette. I got my first job after about 2 years. In 1970 only, I got my first job. And that also as an engineering graduate with a lower salary than the engineer. But we were designated as engineering graduates.
Okay.
So that was my first job, and they put me to Noorelia for 8 months. Then from Noorelia only, I got a job as engineer at a higher salary in the River Valleys Development Board. That is RVDB, which is now no more. which did the Udavalavi project those days.
So what happens next then? You move?
Then the Udavalavi project, I was stationed at a place called Amilipitiya for a few months. Then I was put in charge of a concrete precast concrete production yard. I was put as the engineer in charge of that yard at the present day Angulukola Palace, which was those days a very, very undeveloped area, where my house, where I was boarded in the quarters, was about 500 meters away. So actually, when we go to the site at 10 o'clock in the morning, sometimes our site is fenced right round. I can see elephants grazing, wild elephants. So we were advised not to come out unless, you know, we come out together in a vehicle, or not to come out alone. So even at 10 o'clock in the morning, you can see elephants just far away grazing on the border of the fence on the other side. So it was very, very undeveloped. So it was just starting, and now, you know, you can't recognize or even imagine that I lived at that place in the 1971, 72, 73, that's the period I lived there. So, but now it's a big city, like thing. Amilipitiya is a big city now. Whereas on Sundays, when we want to have breakfast, we could not find a shop or boutique in Amilipitiya. We had to go 1 mile to have a decent breakfast. Now it's a big city, like thing.
Okay.
So right. Is my starting of my career.
Yeah. So you went to the Middle East?
Yeah, after that, from there, because of the distance and the inconvenience and the time taken in traveling long days apart from my newly married wife, and I had a son that time. So I was leaving it very difficult. So I somehow managed to get a job in Colombo in the buildings department. So I completed 2 full years from January 1972 to January 1974 when I joined the buildings department in Colombo. So I was there for 8 years in the design structural design department, fortunately, where I got the opportunity, very early opportunity, to do some big designs which helped me to get my charter. Because charter, when you have to get your chartered engineering, you have to present a design of your own, and design which will be recognized as a sort of a, you know, not a large project, but at least not a house even, but something in between, like a 4-story, 5-story. So I got the opportunity to design a 5-story hospital building in the main hospital area, the general hospital area. So I got that opportunity, and with my Udavalavi experience, 2 years of very hard experience in a very big site, I was qualified to sit for my charter. So I sat for my charter. Those days, the charter was given by the London Institute. So I was one of the, lucky few who got the London charter. So 2 years after that, they did away with the London charter.
Yeah. Tell me, I typically ask everyone this question. What? Can the current generation, new generation, learn something from the old generation that you grew up in?
What I could say is, you know, the old generation, now we need computers and various other instruments, we need accountants and that and this. But the people whom I just said, they had these calculators only, and they were successful. They had that talent. But what I could say is, everything, you know, business is between the seller and the customer. So the customer has to believe in you. He must have trust in you. So you must give him the value that he is seeking for. So I think, as far as only one word I could use, which I used it before. Our old generation, they won the trust of their customers. They were dependable. The customer knew that he won't be cheated. That is one important thing. Because I am very sorry to say, it's very frequently we hear about people being played out. Actually played out in this sense. Even in Juma sermons, this is being mentioned. Karna chumma bounsare chekka kudukadango ara seyyadango senna nerathike karna kudugo. Why they say is they promise something and they don't deliver. But our old generation, I don't think they had that, you know, bad quality in them. They stuck to their word. They went out of their way to honor their word. So these are some, if you, very shortly I could say, trust, T-R-U-S-T.
Yeah.
That was the factor which won the love of the customers, the trust of their customers, and they gave the path for their success. That okay. I could tell you that.
Okay, I think that is a good point to finish. Thank you so much, Engineer Samoon Jalaldeen. Yeah. It has been a pleasure talking to you.
The same here. I also thank you very much for giving me this opportunity, for sharing these memories of mine, and also affording me this opportunity to tell you what I think of the old generation, the new generation, the future of our children, and everything.
Okay.
Thank you very much for inviting me, and it's a very good opportunity I got, Doctor.
Thank you so much. Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum assalam.